So last week, Knives Out finally hit theaters, so today I'm gonna stop and rank all five Rian Johnson films from the worst to the best. Hi, my name is Sean, and I love to talk about movies way too much. With that in mind, go ahead and join me down below in the comment section. Share your ranking of all five Rian Johnson films, or at least as many of them as you have seen. At least one of these movies is definitely very controversial, so please be respectful when talking about The Last Jedi. We're gonna disagree. Let's just do so in a friendly manner. With that said, let's get started. In last place is The Brothers Bloom, a movie that was okay, I guess, but just didn't have anything distinct about it besides the scene where Raquel Weiss juggles chainsaws. But the central plotline premise is actually pretty common standard stuff about a pair of con men where one of them falls in love with the Mark, and that leads to all sorts of complications inside of the story. Now, our three main people are all great actors, Mark Ruffalo, Adrian Brody, and Raquel Weiss, and so, you know, they're fun to watch on screen, but everything just kind of plays out the way movies like this always kind of play out. And I guess from interviews and looking into it, Rian Johnson was trying to make kind of this character study out of it. So while it has all the familiar beats of this type of story, he wanted to be more character driven. And I just didn't care enough about the characters for making it a character driven story for it to kind of connect with me. There's also some tonal inconsistencies with the way it tries to do the humor, and especially when you have people juggling chainsaws on a unicycle, and then it has these really hard, emotional, heavy hitting moments. And it felt kind of like two different movies to me. So this, in certain ways, a very kind of broad sense, seemed like his kind of prototype to try and do something kind of like Knives Out. But I think this was him kind of working out all the bugs, and there's a lot of bugs inside of this one. It's a movie I just can't imagine myself ever rewatching. Coming in at number four is Star Wars The Last Jedi. Oh boy. If ever there was a movie that just split its audience down the middle into two very passionate groups of people, this is it, where one group sees a movie that took their beloved Luke Skywalker and just absolutely ruined the character and betrayed their childhood, and the other side sees a great little character study about fallen heroes and redemption, and doing so in a very different sort of way. And it's like the two groups can't even talk to each other without it getting vicious. Just yesterday, I was debating people on Twitter over the merits of this movie. For me, I tend to be more the group that didn't like what Rian Johnson did with this movie. I don't think it ruined my childhood. I don't think it's an abysmal movie. I just think it's a pretty flawed concept inside of it. A big part of that is I don't think the movie did enough work to get me to accept this version of Luke Skywalker. There's so much that's happened between when we last saw Luke in this movie that he just shows up and he's just acting out of character. And it's just so abrupt, and they needed to do more than a few lines of dialogue and a couple of flashbacks to get me there. But even beyond that, like the whole casino plot line, just, I don't think it makes any sense inside of the movie. It's weird. It's strange. I don't like the Rose character, the way she's used in the film, kind of doing an odd romance with Finn that, once again, I don't think particularly works. I don't think that the Hondo character and the Laura Dern's character, I don't think it made a lot of sense, the decisions that she made in regards to Poe. So it's a movie that I watch it, and I think like the throne room scene is gorgeous. Some of the action is handled great. Some of the, like the performance from Mark Hamill is really good. There is some good subverting of expectations inside of the movie. And then there's a whole lot of moments that I just don't think the story comes together like it should. I don't think it makes as much sense as it should. And it's trying to be clever for the sake of being clever. And in doing so, I just see a movie that has a lot of holes inside of it and leaves me very frustrated. In third place is Brick, a very interesting genre blender as it takes kind of this hard-boiled mystery, the noir genre, and moves it into a high school, and it plays it dead serious. It just goes hard on this very strange mix of genres and creates a very unique cinematic experience. You also get Joseph Gordon-Levitt in one of those very important performances for him, as it back in the 90s, he did Third Rock from the Sun, he's in 10 Things I Hate About You, and then we know him from kind of the last decade, and this is one of those roles that was that bridge, that transition to taking him seriously as a grown-up actor inside of this movie, that it relies on the fact that you can buy him doing what he does inside of this film to kind of tie all of it together. It's got nice dialogue, cleverness inside the way it's structured. I know for me, I was just watching it thinking it was like, well, this is a very odd take on Veronica Mars. It's like a long version of Veronica Mars, or maybe it's a shorter version of it because it's on movie form instead of a season long form, and a lot more serious than Veronica Mars at the same time. A lot of people absolutely love this movie. I can't say that I was one of those people. I was like, respected it more than I was like, oh, that was awesome. I can't wait to watch that again. But a very interesting film to exist. Our runner-up is Looper, a very cool sci-fi hitman movie that is just jam-packed with great ideas and fantastic performances. And so much of what makes it work is just the direction from Rian Johnson himself. There's a sequence inside of this movie where Paul Dano, his character, kind of some stuff goes on with him that there's, you see an older version of him and things happen to him. I don't want to spoil it in case you haven't seen the movie. And the way this sequence plays out is it's one of the most horrifying sequences I've ever seen inside of a movie. It is dark, disturbing. And I was just thinking, like, this scene in and of itself is the, could be the whole premise for a fantastic horror movie. Just right here, you could build so much off of it. That's just one sequence inside the movie. Even the way it plays out, the nature of the timeline stuff and the two versions of the character with Bruce Willis and Joseph Gordon-Levitt, and you see different timelines play out, what could be possibilities. It's just so clever in the way it's handled. Beyond that, there's the whole thing is about world building and establishing all these rules, and you're interested in all the things about it, and they like tease things about, no, you want to go to China, and about the future and all kinds of things that makes this world a place you want to know more about. Like, you don't want a sequel to this movie, but you kind of at the same time want to spend more time there to understand all the intricacies and the way all of it works. And that's when you have great just thought put into this space that the story takes place. Then, of course, you have great performances from our three leads, Joseph Gordon-Levitt, Bruce Willis, and Emily Blunt. And all of it, you just kind of feel sorry for all of them. You're invested in all of them throughout the entire film, even though Bruce Willis's version of the character is doing some pretty awful things. You kind of see where he's coming from with what's happening and the reasons behind all of it. And it's one of those movies that you just think, that is a cool movie. That is a clever script, and he executed it so well. But coming in first place is Knives Out. A bunch of people over the last couple of weeks have been asking me if I'm going to watch Knives Out and review Knives Out. I saw Knives Out actually 2 months ago at Fantastic Fest. Rian Johnson was in attendance. He was just walking around the movie theater, and so I actually snapped a couple of creepy pictures of him at it. So I actually saw it and reviewed it back in September, and I absolutely loved it. It's a whodunit that just does everything right with the genre. First off, you have a fantastic cast of quirky, odd characters. All of them are interesting, fun, and funny in their own way. They have something about them that makes them kind of distinct in their personality and what they add to the film, how they add to the banter inside of it, and they're all played by these A-list actors and fantastic people that just bring so much life to every single scene inside of the movie. But beyond that, what makes it kind of work is the whodunit aspect of it. You actually are on board with it, and it does it in a way where every 30 minutes something happens that changes it all up. So the movie starts, and for the first 30 minutes you're kind of following down this one track, and then there's a reveal, you learn something, you're like, oh, that's what this movie's really about, that's what's really going on here. And 30 minutes later, there's a twist and things go off in a different direction, and 30 minutes later there's a reveal that changes it up again, and then about 20 minutes before the end of the movie you kind of get the final answers and the final twist turns and answers to everything. And so it keeps reinventing itself. It keeps rewriting the narrative that you're watching in all the right ways. It uses all the tricks of the genre to make you intrigued, for the twists and turns to feel earned, and just make a movie that's just a ton of fun. And you can just like literally go through the whole cast. And so many people are saying that Daniel Craig is the standout. Because he absolutely is. But so is Chris Evans and Jamie Lee Curtis. And they're not even the stars in the movie. Ana De Armas is the star of the movie, and she's great in it too. She's not necessarily at, she doesn't pop as much because everyone else is designed to be these kind of like big flamboyant characters, and she's kind of the straight man inside of it. She's that the person that's reacting to all their insanity and their decisions. And so, but she does a great job of being that person that kind of ties it all together without having all the wackiness to her. All in all, I really dug this movie. It's probably going to be in my top 10 of the year, so it comes in at number one. If you've enjoyed this video, I've got more director rankings in that playlist right over there. Quentin Tarantino, James Cameron, M. Night Shyamalan, Jon Favreau, Christopher Nolan, bunch of fun ones. If you've enjoyed this video, there's something else over there that you'll like. Thank you so much for watching, and keep talking movies too much.